Jagat Jaya Surya, your excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, I am happy to be here with you at the concluding session of your deliberations to share some thoughts with you on the basic purpose for which you have got together here in Colombo. I think your deliberations are exceedingly timely, and the objective which we are trying to accomplish is of great importance to both SAARC and ASEAN. As I understand it, what you are seeking to achieve is a more effective mechanism of collaboration. It is not something that is akin to NATO, for example. However, there really is a compelling case for the countries of South Asia and the countries of Southeast Asia to work more closely together in order to grapple with some of the challenging issues that all our countries are confronted with together. So there is a very significant overlap in the problems that we are endeavoring to resolve, and it is quite obvious that a greater measure of cooperation through better organized mechanisms and structures is a dire necessity in the contemporary world. Now, what I would like to do is to focus on some areas, some substantive areas where I think the kind of cooperation that I'm talking about would be potentially very productive. I think the first thing to note is the conceptual backdrop to some of the issues that we are talking about, one of which is a need for South-South cooperation. Our countries in SAARC and ASEAN are all part of the developing world, and it is very important for us to focus on modalities for achieving greater prosperity for our people through better South-South cooperation. Trade is one of the central issues that we need to focus upon. But I have noticed that in many of the fora which I have attended in the last 3 years, many countries in the developing world have complained that their resources are taken away by others, and the lion's share of the profits accrue to other nations. Now, if we focus for a moment on the resources of the ocean, that is important from the point of view of fisheries. It is important from the point of view of oil and gas exploration. From the minerals that we extract from the seabed and the ocean floor. Now, with regard to many of these sectors, I'll take fisheries for example, many of our countries sell the raw product to countries outside the region, and the value addition is done outside. Filleting, canning, value addition, all of that is done outside. Now, if we ourselves are able to do the value addition within our own countries, then obviously the profit that we derive would be very much greater. We permit trawlers, for example, from other countries to come collect the fish, and then what we are paid is a very small proportion of the ultimate profit that is derived from exploitation of these marine resources. We also have to concentrate on shipping, because we are dependent on shipping from other countries, banking, insurance, all these things go together. And we have to provide within the region better networks with regard to each of these areas, shipping, banking, insurance, and so on. I think this is very important. We have to think of banking structures, funds which we establish for our mutual benefit. We have to deal with some of the present roadblocks and inhibitions with regard to the movement of goods across our boundaries, harmonization of customs, quarantine, and other requirements. And this is an area in which I think greater collaboration between SAARC and ASEAN would definitely be beneficial. Apart from that, there's no doubt that the area where this kind of collaboration is most appropriate and represents an urgent necessity is with regard to the preservation of stability, counterterrorism. Certainly, as far as SAARC is concerned, that has been identified by the 8 countries comprising SAARC as one of our first priorities. About 2 years ago, the leaders of the SAARC nations identified 3 priorities for the SAARC region as a whole. And in the order in which they identified those priorities, the topics were counterterrorism, food security, and energy security. Just 3 days ago in Kathmandu, the 8 SAARC countries signed an agreement with regard to energy security. I would look upon that as a landmark achievement. But just as significant as energy security is counterterrorism. Many of our countries are grappling with problems connected with terrorism. So there really has to be far greater cooperation with regard to sharing of intelligence, with regard to evolving effective measures to prevent the movement of funds from one country to another. Terrorist networks in the complex world in which we live do not operate in isolation. There's a high degree of collusion, collaboration among terrorist organizations. So all of this means that countries have to work together. However rich or powerful an individual country may be, it is not able to grapple with terrorism effectively, and there really has to be a concerted effort. That is necessary, but I don't think that that is sufficient. We also need to examine in depth the causes of this phenomenon. Certainly, we have to deal with its consequences and cooperate much more closely with one another in dealing with the phenomenon of terrorism, but we also need to ask ourselves why it is happening. Now, I think one of the root causes is the growth of fundamentalism in many of our countries. Society is looking for their cultural roots, and the polarization that is setting in within many of our countries. Now, at this point, I want to share with you a thought that is very controversial. But this is something that I believe in fervently. You know, these fundamentalist movements, they in many of our societies, they are operating at the fringes. It's not mainstream. Happily, it is not mainstream, it's operating at the fringes. However, the fringe elements are greatly strengthened by the perception that there is undue interference with our countries, intervention from outside. And fundamentalism very often assumes the character of a reaction to that. You know, we have found this in practice, that when there is the perception in a country that outside elements are getting involved in the internal affairs of that country, exerting pressure, the extreme manifestation of it would be regime change. When all of this is happening, it feeds, it nurtures and strengthens the fringe elements of society that are able to whip up what are seen as patriotic feelings, as a buffer against external intervention. Now, it is a great pity that the people who are responsible for the exertion of that pressure do not recognize this reality. You know, in many of our countries, it is a fact that what later became formidable terrorist movements were really financed and encouraged by countries outside the region for their own purposes. Then the political objective was accomplished, but what was left behind was a problem that would take generations to resolve. Now, take Sri Lanka's own case. I mean, all of you are aware that we suffered greatly from a 30-year war. Nobody believed that terrorism could be eradicated from this country by military means, but that was accomplished as a result of a combination of elements, a strong political leadership, close collaboration between the political and the military leadership, the provision of resources that were necessary to overcome terrorism, all of that has happened. Now, the rate of growth of the economy of this country is one of the highest in Asia. It is at the threshold of about 7.6%, and in the north, it is three times as high. And the representative of the United Nations system in this country, Mr. Subine Nandi, is on record as saying that Sri Lanka has achieved more than was expected with regard to the accomplishment of the Millennium Development Goals, and after that, the Sustainable Development Goals. We have achieved all that. But every 6 months, we have to face this problem in Geneva, expending huge resources, it's a commitment of time, energy, because we are being pursued year after year. In three consecutive years, resolutions have been brought against Sri Lanka. Now, these are some of the factors that unwittingly encourage extremist groups in our countries. Because each country has its own societal structure, it has its own cultural traditions. It really is not possible for somebody from outside to walk in and say, we are going to set everything right. And by the time we leave, these countries will be stable, peaceful, governable. What has happened in countries like Libya, Iraq, Egypt? You come in, and then you have a mission, a goal. And then, now in the case of Iraq, the statement was made that when the troops that come in leave Iraq, the country will be peaceful, stable, and governable. Is that the case? Does the empirical evidence support that, the degree of violence? Look at the situation in Libya. Is there one government that rules the entire country? Is that a stable situation? Now, why does this happen? You can come in, a powerful country with military might, economic power, can come in, change regimes, assassinate political leaders. But they leave behind a trail of problems that are going to take a long time to resolve. And it is in that situation that terrorist groups find fertile ground to develop, to expand the area of their activity. His Excellency, the Ambassador of Afghanistan, is here now in Afghanistan. Some of these started during the Russian occupation, as Your Excellency would agree. So, in order to dislodge the Russians, there was an attempt made to finance, train groups, not to hurt the Afghans themselves, but to dislodge the Russians. In the 80s, the Russians went away. But what happened thereafter? What became Taliban, Al-Qaeda, had taken firm root. And then the other lesson is that one can never hope to control a terrorist group that one creates. Far too many people, far too many countries in contemporary history have made that cardinal error. Sri Lanka has also experienced that. There is a country outside, for its own purposes, supporting a terrorist group, believing that that terrorist group is an instrument of its master. And then the country that is spending money and training in camps and so on is confident that this terrorist group is its tool. It can direct the operations of the terrorist group. History demonstrates that that never happens. Once you get the genie out of the bottle, you can't put the genie back in the bottle. You have created a Frankenstein monster that neither you nor anybody else can realistically expect to control. Now see what's happening in countries like Libya. No, I'm speaking to you candidly. That's the whole purpose of an interaction like this. The situation is such that the people who gave the arms are now offering money to buy back the arms. You know, because the groups that were armed were motley groups, not under any central command. So nobody could really control how those arms were to be used. The arms are in the hands of a lot of people who were supposed to be fighting the regime of Gaddafi. Then Gaddafi is killed in the most horrendous way possible. And then the arms continue to be in the hands of the people to whom the arms were given. Then there's internecine warfare. The two governments claiming to have moral legitimacy. And a profusion of groups which are armed. Then there's even an offer to buy back some of the arms. Of course, the people who have the arms are not selling the arms because there's a black market in the arms. So the point I'm making, the central point, is that that kind of external intervention does not really help. Now, this reflection has the support of a very influential thinker from the West, no less than Dr. Henry Kissinger, who fashioned the foreign policy of the late President Richard M. Nixon. There was a book that was published on his 90th birthday, a book on the history of public policy. And in that book, Henry Kissinger makes a very interesting observation. Henry Kissinger says that the central problem of politics and foreign relations today is not the control of wickedness, but the limitation of righteousness. The limitation of righteousness. What he means is that these external powers who are resorting to the kind of behavior that I'm describing to you believe they have a moral mission. They know what is best for our countries. So they're self-righteous. They want to impose their values, their structures, their governance mechanisms on us. This is what Henry Kissinger means when he says the central problem is the control of righteousness. There's no culture that has a monopoly of wisdom. During my recent visits to countries of the Gulf, for example, some of the foreign ministers of those countries, whom I have got to know very well, for whom I have genuine and profound respect, have said, look at this. Look at the culture to which you are heirs in South Asia. Look at our own culture. You know, there is a great deal of wisdom that is encapsulated in the Tripitaka, in the Buddhist cultures, in the Bhagavad Gita, in the Hindu culture, in the Quran, the Hadiths, the Ijmas, the Qiyas, the whole reservoir of wisdom. So, no culture is entitled to claim that it is superior to everybody else's cultural legacy. That is not the case. This is what I think Henry Kissinger has in mind when he makes this very, very relevant observation. That the central problem today is the control of righteousness. People who think that they know everything. They have the answer to all the world's problems. And whoever disagrees with them is either a knave or a fool. That is not the case. And what is happening in countries of North Africa and in the Middle East today is living testimony to the fallacy of that assumption of self-righteousness. So I want to emphasize this to you. Many of our countries need to recognize this, and we have to stand together. This is very important, very important. Our own president, President Rajapaksa, when he spoke in Kathmandu 4 days ago, said that SAARC must recognize this principle, that if one of the members of SAARC is unjustly treated by a country outside SAARC, oppressive, unfair, inequitable behavior that is meted out to a member of SAARC at the hands of a country outside SAARC, there is an obligation devolving on SAARC collectively to show solidarity with the member who is subjected to oppressive or unfair treatment. And that had resonance with the leaders of the countries who were represented. So we must stand together. Our lone voice may not be able to achieve much. But together, collectively, if we pool our resources, our energies, and act in solidarity with one another, we can deal with these problems much more effectively. I would respectfully suggest that that should be one of our priorities as we plan working together in SAARC and ASEAN. We really have to assert ourselves, our cultural traditions, evolve our own solutions. Simply to invite people from outside with large armies and great resources to come in to our countries and to recreate our countries in their image, that does not work. And what is happening, what is unfolding before our eyes is the most eloquent testimony to the reality that that simply does not work in the real world. Then, of course, there are other things that we can do. Sri Lanka is very proud of what we have been able to do with regard to curtailing human smuggling. One of the great problems that are common to SAARC and ASEAN. It is not just a political problem, it is a humanitarian disaster. Look at all the people from our country who have been duped into believing that a heavenly existence awaits them in Australia, New Zealand, and so on. And there are people who make unconscionable profits out of this operation. Sri Lanka entered into a joint working group with Australia, and we have been able to reduce almost to zero the numbers of people leaving our shores via Thailand and so on, to going to Christmas Island. That has almost stopped now. Even a few days ago, we cooperated with the government of Australia in bringing some of these people back to our own country. Piracy is another problem that affects countries of SAARC and ASEAN. Now here, I think it is very useful for you to focus on this. You know, with regard to piracy, there are many issues. One is that the international regime is not being properly enforced. There are huge gaps, there are lacunae in the international legal order. When a country apprehends a pirate, that country has to bear the entire financial burden. There's no assistance that is provided by the international order. There's also the lack of a tribunal invested with effective authority to deal with problems of piracy. There's also the very serious problem that if the ship owner or the country in question pays the ransom that is demanded, there is no effective machinery that is provided by international law to follow that property into the hands of the pirates or those who organize the piracy operation. I mean, don't forget that piracy basically starts on land, not on the water. And the problems are very acute in countries where the government at the center is not in control of the whole of that territory. That is why some of the countries of the Gulf, the United Arab Emirates in particular, have had a series of symposia in Abu Dhabi and Dubai to deal with problems in Somalia and elsewhere. That is very healthy. Countries like the UAE taking a very active interest in this matter. I have myself been present at several of those meetings and delivered keynote addresses. There's also the problem of the pirates using the elaborate structures for registration of vehicles to conceal their real identity, flying under various artificial flags, trying to conceal their real nationality. These are some of the problems that we need to deal with if we want to break the back of this problem. Then connected with piracy and human smuggling is a whole host of other problems, such as the proliferation of small arms, money laundering, all of that. Then countries of SAARC and ASEAN also have to put their collective experience to the task of preventing or at least mitigating tensions arising from competition with regard to oil and gas exploration. That's very important. And also today, now many of the countries that are represented here are jurisdiction in respect of the water body around us is much greater than the landmass that we control. Because today the exclusive economic zone covers approximately 200 nautical miles. Exclusive economic zone covers 200 nautical miles. And almost 90% of the fish stocks in the world come within the jurisdiction of the exclusive economic zone. You know, don't forget that 70% of the planet is covered by water. And 1/3 of that is within the exclusive economic jurisdiction of countries. So there really has to be a proper mechanism for resolving disputes with regard to oil and gas exploration, and also the extraction of very valuable minerals like cobalt, nickel, gold from the seabed and the ocean floor. The blue economy is today a vibrant concept. And for many of our countries, the ocean is the heart of our economic well-being. Isn't that so? Not just agriculture on land, industry, trade, but the exploitation of the resources of the ocean. Not just fisheries, minerals, gas, oil, and so on. So the nation state is still the basic unit. And it is natural that countries would be governed by self-interest. So in order to resolve these conflicts and to evolve structures that focus on collective well-being, much more needs to be done. Then the last point I want to make is with regard to climate change and disaster management. there, we need to emphasize much more the element of research. Being able to, now Sri Lanka was overtaken by the tsunami disaster some years ago. And the reason why that assumed such horrendous proportions was a lack of preparedness. Of course, for centuries we had not had a calamity of that magnitude. Since then, we have concentrated much more on preemption, on avoidance. And at the recent meeting of IORA, the Indian Ocean Rim Association in Perth, Western Australia, I made a compelling case for the countries of IORA. After all, the Indian Ocean has 38 littoral states, 38 littoral states around the Indian Ocean. And they agreed to support a center of excellence in oceanography and ocean studies that is to be established in Sri Lanka. So disaster preparedness, awareness, preemptive measures become very important. And the last comment I want to make is that those of you, I don't know how many of you have visited Colombo in the recent past, say 6 years, 7 years ago. The changes that have taken place here are really unbelievable. I mean, Colombo City today, if you compare what you see today with the condition of the city just 5 years ago, is a world of difference. Hasn't happened fortuitously or accidentally. It has been the result of proper planning and implementation, for which the credit belongs principally to Mr. Gotabaya Rajapaksa, the Secretary to the Ministry of Defense and Urban Planning, who is mainly responsible for this particular initiative, which I say is exceedingly timely and beneficial. Now, it is a mistake to assume that the principal purpose of this is beautification of the city. The city does look very beautiful, there's no doubt about it. But that's not the main objective. That is a byproduct. What we have been able to do is to deal effectively with problems like flash floods. Flash floods is a very serious problem in Colombo and the suburbs, flooding. And that affects housing, it affects health, dengue, the spread of communicable diseases, waterborne diseases, diarrhea, dysentery, all of this. Then there are also serious problems, again, health problems connected with sewage disposal. All of this has been effectively handled under the umbrella of urban development and innovative thinking with regard to urban development. And that is related to climate change, global warming, and I would urge representatives of the countries that are here taking part in these deliberations to raise your collective voice and demand some limited action even today. How much discussion has there been about global warming and climate change at the international level in recent times? Kyoto, Copenhagen, Durban, Rio de Janeiro, the discussions go on and on. And look at our neighbor, the Maldives. They can't afford to keep discussing this problem for the next 30, 40 years. So, of course, it is obvious that this problem cannot be resolved overnight. But let there be some limited action, some meaningful, concrete steps. After all, every long journey begins with one step. Now, today, there is growing impatience in the international community with the lack of action, endless discussion. So there is growing frustration and a strident demand for some concrete action which is going to make the situation even marginally better than it is today. And we can make that happen only if all of us get together and raise our collective voice. So, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, these are the reasons why I think that these discussions are rich and rewarding, rich and rewarding. But they must lead to some concrete action. Must not be just another seminar where interesting thoughts come up and are discussed. Must not be a one-off thing. General Jagat Jayaswari was telling me that it is very much his desire to ensure continuity. He mentioned a country and he said that we were trying to talk to that country to see whether they would be prepared to host this next year. It is also a good thing that you have an outcome document, the text of which he has just shown me, because it is good to have something on record. And that would help follow up. The most important thing, of course, is follow up. So if we recognize the commonality of the challenges that confront us in South Asia and Southeast Asia, Southeast Asia, and if we get together, don't forget, there are very strong traditions, there are very strong resources available to us collectively, not necessarily individually. So if we pool those resources and come together to deal with some of the problems which I have outlined to you, there's absolutely no reason for pessimism. I'm sure that we will be able to accomplish much. So let me conclude by thanking you once again for the opportunity that you have given me to share these thoughts with you. And I shall, of course, be happy to respond to any questions that you would like to ask me, or indeed to listen to any comments and observations that you care to make. I thank your excellencies, ladies and gentlemen.